Welcome to the AHS News. I'm Monica Rangel.
I'm Kylan Raymond, and welcome.
When the State Department of Education released school report cards this year, we celebrated the news that Aynor High was ranked first among schools like us in the state. Being first, or experiencing a first, can be significant.
First of any kind are memorable, worth celebrating, historical, and sometimes even inspiring.
This edition of the AHS News uncovers and discovers some firsts that you might find interesting.
Does first place come easy? Does a first-time experience just happen? Or does it require something else? The AHS News has its own theory.
In a recent interview with students at AHS, 66% said they were either competitive or very competitive. How well does being competitive or having a strong drive affect being first or number one? We asked the members of the AHS family who knows what it's like to be first.
My first place came mostly by a mixture of talent and hard work, because being first, it takes a lot in the music industry, and I'm also really competitive, and so that helped me out a little bit because I just felt the need to beat everyone, or try to beat everyone.
The question is, do you become number one by luck, happenstance, or through work, hard work, that is? There's no doubt what the answer to that question is. We became number one at Aynor High School through hard work. There's no luck having the highest EOC scores in the district. There's no luck graduating high numbers of your seniors. There's no luck having the highest ASAP scores, having the highest ASAP longitudinal scores. Luck happens when you play horseshoes. And we don't play horseshoes at Aynor High School. We work. Through hard work and dedication, that's why we're number one, and that's why we'll stay number one.
Being a state champion wrestler is basically all about your work ethic, and your skill does play along with it. But to me, it's being very competitive, having the mindset, and I'm just a competitive person.
It's not luck that I'm a state champion. I work hard, I train hard, and I compete.
While hard work, determination, and even a strong drive to be competitive can't always guarantee first place, they can guarantee that you will be better than you were. Be the best you can be, Blue Jackets. This is Kyla for the AHS News.
Whether you're feeling lucky or just thrive on competition, Becca Sarvis introduces a new reality-style game show series.
It's a series that guarantees a first-place winner in 60 seconds flat.
Welcome to the first installment of Aynor High School News, A Minute to Win It. If you've ever watched NBC's popular version, you know that the contestants have 60 seconds to complete a challenge. The challenges are different each week, and so are the contestants. The Aynor High School News offers a twist. Our weekly competition will feature contestants competing not only against the clock, but against each other as well.
There's no doubt I'm going to win because he can't even get his head between his legs.
There's no such thing as losing, so I'm going to win.
Congratulations, Hunter. The students lead 1-0, and next week we'll feature one new competition as well with new contestants. Each week's winner will receive a Chick-fil-A treat. See you next time on A Minute to Win It.
Thanks, Becca. Let's see if the faculty can rebound on the next competition.
And speaking of competition, Wyatt McCracken brings us some firsts from the athletic scene.
Before we get to sports, here's a little trivia for you, Blue Jackets. What team won the first state title at Aynor High School, and what year was it in? What year was the first softball team, and what year was the first baseball team? Before I give you the answers, let's talk about baseball. The baseball season is already underway, and first up for the Blue Jackets is the Baseball at the Beach tournament. They had a 2-1 record at the tournament last year, and their loss was to the champions East Rutherford, who were also North Carolina state champions the year before. The Jackets have high hopes for repeating their impressive performance. Coach Chad Sars and his team certainly think so.
I believe that the baseball team has a pretty good shot at winning Baseball at the Beach this year. We got a pretty strong team, a bunch of older guys, juniors and seniors, and we would love for all of y'all to come out and support us. We need all the fans we can get. Go Blue Jackets!
This year at Baseball at the Beach, I think our chances are really well this year. We might go undefeated or maybe as good as last year. We have plenty of talent on our baseball team this year. We didn't lose many players last year. We have very good pitching, so I think we'll be just as good as last year.
Last year at Baseball at the Beach, we played exceptionally well. Coming out of there, we actually finished 2-1 coming off of Baseball at the Beach. We played well against Myrtle Beach, 9-2 victory. We actually had a great game against Northwestern, and then played against East Rutherford and played exceptionally well there, but came up a little short. Good showing there. You know, it's a good test for us. It's good caliber teams. It'll be interesting to see how we fare there. I hope we'll play in there before. It'll be kind of the same opponent, so we'll kind of get a fair share, see where we're at and how we're going to do there.
We look forward to great things at the Baseball at the Beach tournament. It's a great time for our Blue Jackets to shine. Speaking of shining, if you missed the last varsity basketball game at home versus Lures, you missed a good one. The varsity boys upset the Lures Lions. It was a physical game and a complete team effort. It was also a first for Aynor, in a manner of speaking. It was the first time Aynor has beaten Lures in basketball for quite a few years. The Blue Jackets finished with a 4-16 record, but they brought a lot of excitement to the fans this year. The girls' basketball team finished off their season with a 9-12 record. The last game was against Waccamaw. It's a play-in game for the playoffs at Marion High School, in which the girls lost but fought hard. The Aynor wrestling team has also had another first for us. Four people are going to wrestle for the state title in Anderson this weekend. One of them is Ethan Nobles, last year's champion at 112 pounds. Good luck at states, wrestlers. Next week, I look forward to bringing you news about the girls' softball team, who has high hopes of winning region championship. This weekend, the girls are playing at the PD Pitch-Off in Latta, and we wish them good luck. Oh wait, before I go, I have your answers for that trivia from earlier. The first state champion winners were the boys' basketball team in 1946. The first softball team was in 1978. The first baseball team was somewhere around 1939. I hope to see you next time on Winners in Sports with Wyatt.
We go to commercial break featuring another new business in Aynor. First-time customers should pay close attention.
Looking for a new haircut, style, manicure, pedicure, or miracle makeover? The newest salon and barbershop in Aynor may have what you're looking for. Located across from Bagnall's Pharmacy on Main Street, Miracles on Main welcomes men, women, and children of all ages for anything from haircuts and styling to hair coloring, extensions, manicures, and pedicures. First-time customers mentioning this commercial will receive $1 off on their next visit. Girls heading to prom this year can register for a grand prize makeover that includes a cut, style, manicure, and pedicure. Second and third place winners of the drawing will receive a manicure or pedicure. Stop by Mr. Johnson's room to register for the drawing. Whether it's just a miracle makeover or basic haircut you're looking for, stop by Miracles on Main today. Don't forget to mention this commercial.
February is Black History Month and the celebration of influential African Americans throughout U.S. history. Miranda Lane looks at Aynor High's history and two teachers whose first year helped make a little history of their own.
It was in 1966 that the first African American student came to Aynor High School, 2 years before integration was official. It wasn't until the fall of 1968 that South Carolina schools became officially integrated. That fall, as African American students entered the doors of Aynor High, so did the first African American faculty members. Not only were they the faculty members, they were husband and wife, Mr. McIver and Ms. Margie McIver.
Mr. McIver taught history and civics, while Ms. McIver taught French and English. The McIvers were specifically recruited by the superintendent of Horry County Schools for these jobs. These jobs would require teachers who could accept the responsibility and handle the challenges of working in a traditional all-white school. There would be never-before pressures and perhaps situations that would be faced. The superintendent and principal believed that the McIvers were just who they were looking for.
I sat down with Mr. McIver and asked him what that first year was like. Okay, it was really better than I thought it would be, really. I had been told to beware, you might not want to go up to Aynor, be first blacks up there. But once I got up there, it was terrific. The students were terrific.
The McIvers now reside in Conway, and Mr. McIver is a well-known and respected attorney who has his own law practice. We spoke about he and his wife's expectations before arriving at Aynor High.
Our expectations were that we were going to be into a school setting, and we were going to teach school. We just hoped that the students would be receptive, which they were,
What was it like to know that you made history at Aynor High?
Well, I feel very good about it. Very good. Like I said, teaching up there, we made a lot of friends, both black and white. Kids who come back to me as an attorney. We developed relationships with people up there, and it was just great.
As Black History Month celebrates the contributions of African Americans around the country, let's also celebrate the historical contributions that Mr. and Ms. Wimsey McIver made at Aynor High School.
Thanks, Miranda. What a great first to celebrate. February is also a month to celebrate our country's presidents. Quentin Gore's radar has discovered some firsts about our commanders-in-chief.
Hello, Blue Jackets, and welcome to another segment of On the Radar. I'm Quentin Gore, and February celebrates President's Day, and many of our nation's presidents have experienced some firsts that you may not know about.
Did you know Calvin Coolidge was the first and only president to be born on the 4th of July? How about this? Teddy Roosevelt was the first president to ride an airplane, and Andrew Jackson was the first to ride on a train. I even got a better one. Franklin Roosevelt was the first to be on television broadcast, and William Taft was offered a contract to play with the Cincinnati Reds. Oh, and we can't forget this. Ulysses Grant was the first president to exceed the Washington speed limit while on a horse and fined $20. But let's not leave out old John Adams. He was the first president to ever live in the White House.
Most of our presidents may or may not be remembered by their terms in office and their achievements. However, hopefully you will now remember them by their noble achievements outside of the office.
As we say goodbye, remember that being first, feeling first, or making it first to be memorable. Be first, Blue Jackets. Earn it, keep it, and celebrate it.